prepare to attack the enemy's control points.
Get behind me, Doctor!
I am fully charged!
You are listening to Control Point, a Team Fortress 2 podcast, with Brent Copeland, Eric Fullerton, Wes Wilson, and Spencer Williams.
Control Point, episode 14, recorded on January 20th, 2008. I'm Brink.
I'm Eric Fullerton.
I'm West.
I'm Spinker. Spinkerly Owens.
Spinker.
Wow. Welcome to Control Point, everybody. Hey.
Another podcast in the house.
Yay.
Number 14. In Eric's house, actually.
Yeah.
Number 14. Who thought we'd make it to 14?
I did.
I thought we'd make it to 4.
Really?
And then we, you know, one of us would die.
Would you say you're kind of a half empty or no cup kind of person?
I thought Brent would be the one to die.
And I did in episode 10. It's documented.
By a rail car.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Briefcase time?
Sure.
So we have two briefcases. I don't know why, but they're both identical. So I'm going to open one and hope that's the real one.
Okay.
Ready?
Are they marked? Do you like have A and B on there?
Well, one's red and one's blue. So really, they're identical other than the color.
Pick the blue one.
Okay, we'll open the blue one. Ready? Let's see what we got here. There's a kukri in here. There's a little note that says, "Now that's the LAN party over. How did it go?" And there's a head crab. Okay, that's the wrong one. Okay. Someone else opened the other one.
Open.
Okay, you guys, really, I just want to point out that Eric writes these stupid little briefcase bits in like his own head in like 5 seconds, and they're always terrible. So anyway,
I'm surprised you think 5 seconds. I think he's been thinking about this since the last podcast.
As far as I'm concerned, this is the best briefcase bit we've ever done.
Well, that's just because it was self-referential. Anyway, in the briefcase, what do we have? We have an artwork contest that we're going to be talking about. We've got more CP server information. I think that should just be a given at this point. Let's see. We've got listener tips. We've got hey, what's that last word?
Dustbowl.
It's beginning to look a lot like Dustbowl.
If you've never played Team Fortress 2 before, Dustbowl is a map on which you play.
How do you spell it?
You spell it CP_DU. Okay, stop. Stop whistling. God, everyone stopped listening to the podcast already. Yeah. Like, this one's just crazy.
Well, some people don't know how to spell.
Yeah.
And have maps, and they don't have maps of how to spell Dustbowl.
We're learning them good stuff here.
I want to see CTF_Dustbowl. I hear that's an awesome map.
Pretty sweet.
Okay.
Who wants to talk about their week first?
So I'll go.
Okay, Brent, how was your week?
I'll jump into it. It was a lot of more server stuff like it is pretty much every week, but we've put up another server online, which is now the clan server, which is private. People can get on anytime. The password is practice with leet letters, basically, for the vowels. And
all this information can be found on our forums under CP server information.
Yes.
The forums.
And the cool thing about this one is we're going to use it for the clan matches, so we don't have to bring down the other server necessarily. It is 21 slots, 10 for each team, and then one for Source TV, which will be recording all the time. It's automatic. Every time you're playing, it's recording.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's cool.
And we'll figure a way to get it where it's easy for everybody to go look at those maps, wherever that's located. We put a new mod on the server, meta mod and source mod, which there's a lot of plugins you can throw in there.
Oh, God.
And a lot of silliness that can go along with it.
Yeah. Awesome silliness.
I don't know.
I never started it. I just want you to know I never started the silliness. I just had to defend myself.
And now I get tells like constantly while you're playing, please do this or please turn on gravity, turn off gravity.
I think we need to take it off. I think it's too great of a temptation.
It is
for me to become a heavy with no gravity. And who was it? Someone on one game. I was like, it's like a big dangerous balloon. Because we were playing on Mach 3, and I just am floating around shooting people, and And then I think someone kicked me off.
You know, I actually got my sniper numbers up a little bit this week because once the gravity goes off and everyone is just kind of, it's like skeet shooting. So I would pull out the sniper gun and I would just watch all the people.
It's like duck hunt.
So what do y'all think about having like a specific night that is like fun server night that where we just like turn it all on and every once in a while turn off clipping and.
Drug mode is cool too.
I love just turning everybody into a time bomb and then logging off.
Oh yeah,
I need
yeah,
to find out how you do that all at the same time.
That was
time.
Rude.
Yeah, me
too. It's I'll tell you offline.
And it was fun. Like when it first showed up, of course, you know, I don't know what I'm doing. Brent all of a sudden turns me into an explosive device, and I'm going doot doot, and everybody's confused, going, Wes, what's going on? I'm like, I don't know, but get away from me. So then I had to go into the server admin controls. I'm like, what? What's this? Huh? And meanwhile, you know, I'm trying to play at the same time and you just can't do it. You gotta take time to, you know. And then I'm trying to figure out who's on my team and who's on the other team so I can blow them up. And yeah, it was fun.
What's the World War II source game? I forget what it's called.
Company of Heroes?
No. It's a World War II Half-Life mod. And,
oh,
source. I don't know. No. Anyway. Can't believe I can't remember what it's called. Anyway,
Call of Fortress.
The first time I played it, the mod had something where if you ever team killed someone, you would automatically go up for a vote where that person could make you explode. And the thing was, you didn't just explode; you killed everyone in like a 50-meter radius around you.
Wow.
And it was unplayable, and I thought it was actually part of the game, and I quit, and I didn't play it again for like 2 years.
I don't blame
nice.
You. Yeah, I don't think you missed out on much.
How was the rest of your week, Brent?
It was really good. We had another good practice night we went through, which you can read more about on the forums. And then, let's see, the other night we had a clan come on. I love it when clans come on and mess with us. And when I say love it, I don't. So that means we'll get more on just here. But Clan No Go, I believe it was, came on and they just played some Right Said Fred. No. What was it? Man, I can't remember the song. It was stuck in my head for like 3 days. But they just opened their mics and kept playing it. And they wouldn't shut up. And I kept telling them to turn it off. And finally, I had to gag them. And then they finally left after a while.
Wow.
So that's fun. So yeah, the Spanish Clan Nova, which I think is No Go. So.
Yeah.
Huh.
I don't know.
But that's about it. My week.
Someone's cell phone is ringing.
Not mine. It's not me.
Not mine.
I turned mine off.
Oh, well. Anyway, so that was your week. Is that it for your week?
Yeah, that's it for my week.
Okay.
I was trying to speed it up because I know we got a busy podcast.
Do you want to go next or do you want me to go next?
It doesn't matter. Would you prefer?
I've got a hammer. I'll hit you with it.
Then I'll go first.
Scatman.
Okay, go ahead.
That's what it was. It was Scatman. I just remembered. Sorry.
I like that song.
Yeah.
Okay, well, we played a lot of custom maps this week. I was, you know, with all the new server stuff going on, everybody was all excited to try new stuff. We tried a couple of new maps. There was one called Vertigo that's actually a remake of a Counter-Strike map that was really, really cool. Everything's on a building, and if you happen to run too far, you go off into the great abyss. I've got a great screenshot of you falling down, Eric. You're as a heavy, and you're just your arms and legs are.
See, I remember I played that map with you, and I don't know what was going on, but we were just completely steamrolling the other team at every opportunity.
Yeah, that would be when I was on the other team than you.
No, you were on the same team with me. We kept winning over and over again, or I just kept shooting you.
No, I wasn't. You were shooting me, yes.
Oh.
I remember you being on the capture point and me running and trying to get it and dying.
Okay, well, let me rephrase the question. What was up with that one time where we were just completely owning you over and over and over again?
I don't know. I actually think that Vertigo is one of the only gravel pit style, you know, three cap point maps that has actually weighted in favor of the defense.
I'm not talking about we just kept winning on defense. I'm talking about we won on defense, and then we were on offense, and we won that.
I don't remember that part.
Now, there is something on the server every once in a while, and this annoys the crap out of me, that it'll be like 11 against 13.
I've noticed that, too.
And I don't know if it's some kind of just visual bug or if it's actually 11 against 13.
We've got an auto balance problem, and I don't know how to fix it. The only thing that I can think might be going on is if someone's sitting in the lobby and hasn't chosen a class yet.
Right.
But I have noticed that we're getting, and that's, remember that I talked about it a few weeks ago about somebody actually leaving our server because the auto balance was off.
Well, there's a timer on it. There's no problem with it.
No, there's almost a, you can stay two over, yeah, basically. And you, we can set it to one. But yeah, to me, I was just thinking, well, wouldn't that just, if it was like 11 against 10, wouldn't it just one guy keeps flipping?
No, that's not how it works.
No, that's not how it works.
You can adjust the timer down to be instant if you want, but.
So we just need to change that to one then,
yes,
instead of two.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Problem solved.
Yep. Excellent. We also played a map called Mario Kart this week.
Oh, yeah. I put that on there.
Mario Kart appears to be a map made by somebody who's a big 4chan fan, because there's lots of odd imagery all over the place.
Stupid.
The place is done in 8-bit Dayglo color. There are 4chan large blocky cars running around the Mario Kart track.
It's brilliant.
It is. At first, you're just like, oh my God, a unicorn vomited all over the screen. And then, after a little while, you're having so much ridiculous fun. It's a horrible sniper map. You're getting sniped all over the place, but you can jump in the little cars and ride around and shoot people, and it's great.
Is it like a koala crapped a rainbow in your brain?
Yes, it's exactly.
And you
what
can change
like
the music too. That was always fun.
That was hilarious.
Yeah, custom music, custom textures.
When the ministry came up, that really cracked me up.
What song was it?
I can't remember the name of it. But like one of the trucks even has 4chan written on the side of it. Also, just to add more fun to the map, there's no objectives.
Yeah, it's deathmatch.
There's no intelligence to capture. There's no control points to capture. It's just an experience to be there amongst the koala crap.
Hmm. Or deathmatch. It's old death school match, yeah. Quake action, yep. You know. But yeah, you can spend hours in there easy.
Yes.
And then when you turn the gravity off, it becomes
we turn the
more
gravity
fun
off, and that's when I was doing the skeet shooting, and then yeah, it was a hoot. I had a lot of weird reactions with our community this week. First off, I was actually playing with some people that I really get to play with, and someone goes, "Wow, nobody told me Wes was a good medic."
Nice.
And I went, well, thanks. That was the first class that we covered, and I said I was a good medic then. And yeah, so that kind of hurt my feelings.
What did he think you were good at? Just Demo Man?
I guess Demo Man, which I'm good at Demo Man too.
You're pretty good at Demo Man.
The second thing is I've got a lot of people who think I know stuff about the server, and it's very flattering. Brent makes me look good.
You're welcome.
Actually, I mean, that's a problem that I think you and I both have, because neither Wes nor I really have much to do with the server admin at all.
I actually think I am the most uninformed person of this group. I mean, just being realistically, I think all of you people know more about the game, about computers, about the servers, and everything than me. I am just a talking head in this little game show.
I'll agree with
a
that.
A pretty one.
Well, how about this? We'll let you have one change this week that's all you.
Well, no, you don't understand. It would be an uninformed decision. I'm an uninformed person.
You know what? Sudden death.
Say
sudden death. What class do you want everybody
cheese
to turn into?
Cheese. Cheese.
Sudden death?
Yes.
I want everyone to become
cheese.
And random can be a choice, but
Gouda.
A medic.
Smoked
medic.
Gouda.
Everyone should be a medic for
sudden death.
For sudden death.
Smoked cool. Smoked Gouda medic.
It is done.
Smoked Gouda is delicious.
Yes, it is. And actually, yeah, I'm sitting here and I'm watching Brent. He actually just updated the file on the server. So as of now, and sudden death, you turn into a medic. So thank Wes for that.
Nice.
I think that's a great way to do it.
Next one, I'm going to change it to spies, because now I can turn friendly fire on.
What else on your week there, Wes?
Okay. I caught some people getting bossy again.
Wes?
This cracked me up. And don't get me wrong. There are some we have some excellently informed people in our group, but it's really great when I start hearing people start to get bossy on the server. Guys, get over here. Do this. Guys, get over there. And I'm like, you are not Spencer. You cannot get away with that.
I didn't know I could get away with that. I get called on it every time it happens.
And sort of on the same lines, we actually had what I consider to be our first real flame war this week.
It wasn't even anywhere close to a flame war.
Well, but people actually accused people of being something. And I just want to I posted this on the forum, but I just want to go ahead and say these are my rules of debate and see if you agree with me. Mm-hmm. When you're arguing with someone, you can always keep the argument very, very neutral as long as you always attack their ideas and not them.
You're a liar.
See, no.
Not only that, but you're stupid.
I know.
You're a stupid liar.
And I'm a jerk. I know.
God.
But
why don't you crawl back to 4chan?
Anywho,
this has been an example of how not to act on our forums.
Yes. Just so you understand, everyone out there understands the basic idea that I have is that you can call somebody a liar without calling them a liar. You can say, well, from what you've said here and from what you've said here, this contradicts. but the trick is you say, and it appears to be a lie, because what you're doing is you don't want to label somebody. You don't want to say you are a liar.
I think it's better to label them as ignorant.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Because people can lie by accident, which really just makes them ignorant.
Right, but I don't think you should call people ignorant. But I don't think that makes for healthy discussion.
Anyway, you know, to do it in a roundabout way, I'm saying, it appears you're ignorant is better than it appears you're lying.
Well, basically, as long as you say it appears, it's fine.
Don't be calling people names on the forum. I mean, unless you're joking around, and even then, make sure they know that you're joking around.
And the truth of the matter is, nobody on the internet knows anybody else. So for you to attempt to identify a personality trait or a particular behavior of someone, it's foolish. You don't know. You got no clue.
So I know you. Can I call you a liar?
You know me in real life. You can call me a liar, right? Just like you call me sweet daddy.
Okay, you lying sweet daddy. Anyway.
So
let's move on.
So that's the West week over. How did it go?
Huh? I had a great week.
Now that's the West week over.
I missed it.
I'll go next.
That was too clever for
me. Next.
Okay.
I had a pretty good week. I got some decent play time in for, given the fact that I'm selling a house and all that nonsense. But I've sort of decided that I'm tired of all of my class numbers being the same. Like, everyone has the same number of hours on them. So I am doing nothing but playing heavy.
That's a good idea.
Are you trying to make that your NPC?
You know, that reminds me. This week, I was playing, and we were on Two Fort, and it was a pretty serious group of people on. They were, you know, really hardcore about winning, and I was trying to, you know, joke around and chat, and they weren't really laughing because they were too busy trying to win. And but all of a sudden said, we got two engineers. They're in our elbow.
Nice.
No way.
Yes, they said in our elbow.
Way.
And I was like, no! No, it's not called that. Don't call it that.
I've heard it called that twice this week.
Oh,
as well.
Oh my God! And I'm so, and I know that's all our fault.
We can thank Brent for that one, right? Stupid, elbow.
Yeah, stupid Brent. Brent's a liar.
No, my idea is a lie.
Anyway, the other thing I wanted to note is, oh my God, it is so hard to get on Control Point US number one.
Oh, wow.
It is.
It is so hard. It was one, I think it was night before last, I hopped into queue and I start getting tells from other people that are in queue. They're like, oh, are you trying to get on the server? I'm like, yeah. And then I see that I just click on, who was it? Clyde Frog. And I say, join game. And he's not on the CP server. And I joined this other server, and it's immediately sort of a dark and scary place because it's not our server. And it says, you know, say whatever you want, do whatever you want. We don't care. I'm like, oh my God, it's going to be like people are calling everyone, you know, ethnic slurs and everything. I'm going to be like, I want on my server. Anyway.
And then the killer came out with a claw.
They were playing the Super Mario Brothers castle.
Oh yeah.
SMB castle, I think is the name of the map.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a terrible map.
We played it on the CP server the other day.
I did not.
I uploaded that.
The one thing I like about it is the catapults. I want to see more rats with catapults.
I think the catapults are a good idea, but this is my experience with the catapults. You go and jump on a catapult, and you land, and there's two completely leveled up turrets just waiting for you.
Yes. Oh, it's a bunch of death. It's a bunch of death.
It's so balanced in favor of defense that I think it's crap.
Now, if you could put a turret on the catapult,
oh, and throw it into the middle.
Ooh, yeah. Wow.
I don't think you can get away with that.
I don't anything. Think you can. Yeah. But it was kind of funny because
because
I keep up our server window, and I keep checking it every once in a while to see how many people have got in front of me. And like 8 people got onto our server before I finally did.
Well, we've got it weighted against you.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I found if you just hit refresh. Keep hitting your refresh on it all the time, you get in faster.
That's totally untrue.
Yeah, if you hit the elevator if you hit the elevator buttons, it goes faster too.
I'm telling you, there is no set thing that says who gets to go first. It's all whoever's auto refreshes and says, "Oh, there's an empty slot," and pushes you in.
Mm.
So if you sit there and refresh, when it
don't say this on the air, dude.
Well, I told you the other secret earlier.
Hacks. Oh my God, hacks.
Hacks.
Okay.
Was there anything else on my?
Now there's actually play on the other servers now, though.
Yeah, we've got more servers. So
that was the other thing is I was having trouble getting on the other servers at the time. Like I tried to get on the EU server and it said you cannot connect to server 0.0.0.0. And I was like, well, that's not the actual IP address, but whatever. Mm. And then the other two servers, control point number 2 was down for some reason and control point number 3 wasn't yet up. So have we talked about control point number 3 and what's going on with that?
We've got it coming up. Okay. So
interesting. Anyway. Interesting note. Right now, U.S. number 1 is full and is playing Dustbowl.
Hmm. Eric, how was your week?
My week was good. I'm doing a movie trailer, so I'm popping in and out of TF2. But I have a lot of time sitting in front of my computer, so you know I'm usually
so message you
always. Yeah, I'm always on Steam, although I'm either editing or playing TF2. So I started off putting a bunch of new maps on the server because I love going to FPS Banana just to see what's brand new. I put on Vertigo, and that was the map we're talking about where it's actually an old Counter-Strike map. So it's a matured map, very polished, and it looks really good with you know all the TF2 textures and stuff.
I like it a lot.
Super Mario Brothers or SMB Castle, put that up there because you know I'm a Mario fanboy. Put it up there, and the coolest thing about it is we already said it's the catapult.
He totally is a Mario fanboy. Every Thursday is dress up as Mario Thursday for Eric.
So let me ask you this, Eric. In the Mario games, is the castle there, is it supposed to be a movie set in the game?
No.
Okay.
See, yeah, but there was movie set stuff there, too. And that's one of the things I thought. There's one sign in there that says, if this light is on, then we are filming.
Yeah, I think the joke is that they're filming a Mario movie there.
But are they?
No.
I mean, where did we get the Mario thing? Just because it's SM in the name?
SMB, Super Mario Brothers.
So that could stand for something else.
It doesn't.
It could.
You're wrong.
But I don't know.
Anyway, I saw the one sign that said, if this light is on, we are filming. Do not disturb. And of course, the light's always on because you can't turn lights on and off and on the maps. And I thought that would make a great spray.
There's another camera in the Mario Kart.
If this light is on, you are about to die. Something like that.
Yeah. There's another camera. It's an Arri Flex camera. It's a film camera. It's sitting upstairs in the Mario Kart level.
Hmm.
So I don't know what the deal is with cameras in Mario. But that's another one I uploaded was Mario Kart, and it's fantastic. We already talked about that.
Fantastic in a what the hell am I doing kind of way.
Yeah. And also I put on Impact, and that is made by the same guy who makes the Mach series.
Which one's Impact?
Impact, it is... I don't think you played Impact.
Okay.
It's hard to describe, too, because there's not really very many... Oh, there's breakable glass in it. You know what I'm talking about? It's a big, long tunnel, and there's a long glass that you can break, and periodically the glass will be rebuilt, and it'll say Red's glass is rebuilt.
Oh, no, I don't know.
Yeah, okay, it's really cool. And also this week, Mach 3 came out. Mach 3 was kind of... a beta, or it was kind of a private map. It was a SIVO map.
Is it different from the SIVO map?
I haven't seen any difference. So, okay. I'm not sure. I know that there was one bug that he fixed, something that had to do with the server crash.
Oh, okay.
And I know that we were suffering from that too at one point. So maybe that's gone and we can put it back in rotation if it's not already. So then I put, a few maps made by some of our listeners on the message board. One is called Touchdown, and it's a huge map where, you basically are playing football in TF2. It's wacky.
Is that like
it's a sniper fest.
Basket Intel?
Yeah, it turns into a sniper fest.
It's a sniper fest, and I hate it.
Oh, yeah, and Basket Intel is another one I put up. That one's interesting.
Have you seen that one, Spencer?
You did?
Yeah.
Basket Intel is a basketball game, and what you have to do is get the intel from the common location, and then you have to get to where to your thing and jump through a hoop like a basketball goal. And it actually, it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I would love to see like that in a, like a real NBA game, like Shaq blow someone up with a rocket launcher or something like that.
Great. But yeah, the Basket Intel game was actually a lot of fun.
I like it. I like it.
And but it's tricky. It sort of changes how you look at the game. You mm-hmm. kind of have to pick your classes differently than other maps.
Yeah.
Now, did y'all play it with regular gravity or only in that game where it was?
We did it with both.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I did it with both.
And okay. It was still fun?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
And the last map I put up was Duel, and that was made by another listener.
I haven't played that one yet.
Is CTF Duel?
It is, yes, it's Capture the Flag. It is a beta map right now. Textures are limited, but it's got a neat structure to it. Right now, it suffers from being sniper map because you can snipe right into the spawn area. So,
wow.
So a millisecond after you spawn, you're dead.
Yeah.
Wow. Once that gets fixed and the textures get placed, I'm sure it'll be a nice map. So, and let's see, other than the maps I put on, let's see, what did I do? I played a lot. I don't know. I just played a lot. I guess played a lot of new maps. Hung out on the forums a lot, trying to catch up because I was stuck in the queue pretty much long enough to catch up on the forums. And I noticed, well, I guess we'll talk about the other servers in the news. Yeah. But yeah, that's about my week.
Cool. Sounds like you had fun.
Wacky custom map time.
Let's see. I have to say that Brent over here has been desperately searching for SMB Castle and prove it to us that it does not stand for Super Mario Brothers, and it actually stands for Saturday Morning Breakfast.
Nice.
Well, that makes a whole lot of sense.
It does. Yeah. So that explains the catapult and the acting, yeah, actors' chairs and all the directors.
Yeah.
And,
it also explains the complete and total lack of breakfast food.
Yeah.
So anyway, news.
News.
We got on the loudspeaker.
We actually had a CP member do some research, and they studied cap point mechanics. And I found this, being the math dork that I am, to be very, very interesting.
Yeah, let's limit our discussion of this.
Yeah, maybe not interesting to talk about. Yeah. Really interesting to post and put a link up for.
Okay,
though.
Well, I actually have something interesting to talk about it.
Okay. Nice. Okay. I'm all ears.
The one piece of information that I think is applicable is that it does not matter if you have more than four people on the cap.
That is interesting. Yeah.
So I told you. So I told you it was interesting, and you believe me. Anyway,
with that supposition.
So if you are capturing capturing a capture point with a bunch of people, and there is four people on there solid, the other two people can run around and help defend. They don't need to stand on the point.
It won't capture the point
any faster.
Now, does that mean that two scouts?
Yes, as long as the times four multiplier is there, it will not cap any faster with more people.
Excellent. Who put that up? Do we know?
I do not remember.
Wow.
Thank you.
That's really mean. We will have a link to it, and there is a person responsible for this, and they deserve a lot of credit for doing a lot of work, and we have failed to deliver that credit here on this podcast.
Thank you, random person.
That was very complete.
The second thing is, now Eric told me about this earlier. Do you want to cover that?
Oh, the multi-core activation. So apparently there is a way to activate the multi-core or multi-threaded capabilities of TF2, and there's a forum discussion about that right now on exactly how you do that. And there's been I think it was Mijawin, there was accounts that it has improved frame rates just by enabling this. I think that it is a test kind of thing, maybe a debugging kind of a development inside thing, whereas this will probably be patched into a new update.
Well, I know there's actually some history on Valve and the multi-threaded stuff. They multi-core processors first became real big, Gabe Newell came out and said, this is terrible. Mm-hmm. It's going to completely swamp all development teams in trying to use this sort of threaded processing, and it will never ever work right.
Really?
And then he put his money where his mouth is, and they spent 2 years developing this really robust multi-threaded application process. that honestly I was surprised was not in release with the orange box. So okay. I'm glad to see that it's actually there, and I'm going to try it out for one, because they use this. I could go into such processor dorkness on this, but I'm not going to. They use a really interesting method of multi-core processing. And I want to see how it works.
And I don't think we really need to go into details about it, but there will be a link on our forums to how to activate it. Because I have a multi-core processor, and I'm all for it. So.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Wow. Moment of silence.
Next, we have lots and lots of new servers popping up left and right.
Oh, my God.
We have, you know, as everyone knows, we have US number one, and that's the most populated server. It's public. Then we have the second one, which is a private one, and this one was donated by Heroine, not like the drug, more like Wonder Woman. And
Wonder Woman is a drug.
This is a private server to kind of help the flow, the overflow, so that CPU users can just go in and play with other CPU users. It, the password right now is Wes, lowercase, all letters.
I remember he sent in that email, "I'm terrible at making passwords." I thought that was funny.
Yeah. So. Wes, you're now a password. So that is private. It's not being used a lot. I looked through the history, and it rarely gets up there. And I think it might be due to the lack of password knowledge. I don't think a lot of people know.
Yeah, I think it's I don't forget who was talking about it, but a couple of us were talking about it the other day, was with it being passworded, there's not a seed of people like control right. point. If there's four or five people on it, well, everybody sees there's four or five people, even people that don't belong to CP, mm-hmm. and a few more will join on.
Yeah.
And then it's like all suddenly this big server, whereas this one's passworded. All they're going to get is CP folks.
I think right. that it's going to be a great server for when we have scheduled functions.
Yes.
But it's a passworded server, which means it's never going to be full all the time like our primary is.
Well, I think the way to do this, guys, is to get on that server and then tell someone, hey, come on the server, especially if you see them waiting for the other server. Oh, go yeah. play on that server while you're waiting.
Yeah, that reminds me, back in the old days when our primary server was password protected, the way it always got full is someone would hop on and then ask us to post a Steam announcement, and then it would fill up fast.
That's right.
So maybe that same kind of thing would work.
Yeah. So that's there. That's US number two, and that's also linked on the front page. We have 1, 2, and the EU server linked on the front page. As we get more, and we do have more coming up, or maybe they're already up right now. We'll
yes,
link those as
this
well.
One's up.
Yeah.
The next one is donated from Deg. He's doing a podcast right now, isn't he?
Some other people help out with that podcast. I think
I know Cardinal and Deg,
Mint Condition. Yeah, the three of them.
They all have nice radio voices. Too.
Yeah, yeah. They
you'll get to hear some of them later. Actually,
that's true. Yeah, they called in.
They have a I think it's a movie and entertainment podcast that's been on hiatus for I think the last year and a half, and they're starting it back up, and sort of as a means of promotion. They're paying entirely for a server that is a control point server, but it's going to have their website address up on the little nag messages. Yeah. So that'll be there. And of course, do we have a link up to them yet?
No, not yet.
We'll put that up as well. Yeah. So thanks a lot, guys. That's really cool.
Yeah. And so that's another US server, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's going to be public, private, clan?
That is public. I played on it last night.
I'm not sure if he intends for it to be public in the long term or not. He's not a very good server admin yet. He has never done it before, and so it's pretty basic at the moment. And he's going to work on.
He got some experience last night. We were playing. He's like, Wes, how do I do this? I'm like, good luck.
Yeah,
and we do have we put up a new forum for all the people who are starting servers and admining on servers to look at. That we're trying to get a lot of this information in there to try to help out, because I just haven't really had enough time to have kind of one-on-one with each
right.
server team. And if we get more servers, I don't think that's necessary if we have a forum where they can go in, ask questions with each other. So right. hopefully yeah. that'll take care of it.
The
so.
Control point server network.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's awesome.
Are you going to talk about that one?
Oh, and then also, we have an EU server that I didn't mention. That would be our EU number one. That's public, and
it gets some decent traffic.
Yeah, it gets some decent traffic at weird hours, but that's our weird hours. They're normal hours.
Yes.
So when I look at it, there's no one there. But then again, you know, I'm looking at it when I play, and I play like 10 at night to midnight or so.
They're steadily climbing in the server rankings, so they're doing okay.
So it's doing good. I think that's still necessary to have one, at least one EU server. Now we have a second EU server, and that's being donated from Peast. Thank you very much.
Yes.
And that is used for, well, the spillover from the first EU server.
Yeah, and he's not actually paying for that server. He owns the server, or his work owns the server, and they're letting him put something up on it. So eat up
his company's CPU cycles. Yeah.
And that's awesome. And if, you know, if that picks up, we might just try to move the traffic from the game server's EU one over to that one if he doesn't mind.
Yeah. Especially since the game server still has not sent us a check.
For all the sponsorship. Just a quick note that our mods, just to reinstate who the mods are, who to look at to yell at when they turn on drug mode or teleport you somewhere illegal, and that is Clyde Frog, Mr. Eagle, and John Maz. Thank you for modding and stuff.
It's never us.
No, yeah, I had one note on that, and walking on eggshells here, but if you have a complaint about one of the mods, send us an email and we'll investigate it and look at it that way. I had one tiny little complaint this week that I'm not going to talk about here, but it was no real big deal. But again, these guys are just volunteering their time, and we really appreciate what they do. And
don't hassle them with wanting like no gravity or something like that all the time, because that's not really their call so much to make. Because like we said on here, we don't want to have no gravity all the time and just random times. We're gonna try to do it at like specific times, so there's no reason to bug them about it.
Or especially like if we've been drinking, we'll just go around randomly killing people, and you know what I mean.
And when we say we mean Eric.
that's not true. On your birthday, you were a crazy person, Brent.
You were crazy on your birthday, though, right?
He was a monster. He couldn't be stopped. And finally, I just quit playing the game. And I think that there is a secondary overarching game that can be played with admin controls. I think it's an RTS where you got all these forces running around and then one person is giving the orders, you know?
Oh, I think that'd be great where if we put an admin on each team and, like, you have all the admin powers. Use them.
Wow.
Yeah. But exactly. No one else gets them.
Yeah.
You know. It's okay to do that on your birthday, Brent, but you say every week is your birthday.
Well, it is.
And I hate birthday mode. I hate it.
Oh, no.
It screws up my frame rate, and I hate it.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, it does?
I love it.
Is it the hat?
Yeah. The balloons that screw up my frame rate.
When people die and the little unit, the tricycle wheel flies out, that kills me.
I saw a license plate jump out. That's cool. I like the random stuff.
And when you really hit somebody and they just explode in confetti and balloons, that makes me so happy.
You know what? I got on the server and I turned it off, and I immediately got like six people saying, thank you. Oh my God. Really? That's so annoying.
I believe you're full of hate and rage, but not our.
Moving on. We do have we're gearing up a artwork contest, correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh yeah.
And there's been some talk on the forums about this, we want to get some artwork together to put as a Team Fortress 2 themed calendar. Now, distribution of the calendar may be strictly, you know, download the images and make your own calendar with it, because we don't want to get into any copyright disputes with Valve, who have more lawyers than we do. The idea is users, because none of us are really fantastic authors, our CP users will make artwork, send it in, and we'll figure out how we're going to judge it. We think we're going to pick out the best ones and put them up for a community vote or something like that. Mm-hmm. Although Wes hates that idea. And
I want dictatorial control.
He wants dictatorial control. Let's see. What are our prizes, Brent? I'm sorry. Hold on just a second. Brent, what are our fabulous prizes?
Well, that really depends on whether you've fallen in love with that Bluetooth mouse yet or not.
No.
Then there will be a Bluetooth mouse from Razer. This is the something something mouse, the Mobile Click 72489. And I have completely made up those numbers. And there may be other fabulous prizes like shirts and buttons and even a calendar.
Sorry.
So yeah, we're gonna have a link up to the image requirements. I think Brent looked them up, and we'll put those up, and just email them to us at cp@deadworkers.com, and we'll enjoy them in private before we release them to the public.
cool.
Yeah.
Yes. And then we had another contest that was run by Mija Wynn.
Who's that?
That's very nice of you.
Who's Mija Wynn? I don't know who you're talking about.
Mija. Mija.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I know him. I know him.
I believe this was for the card, the Dragon Kite card.
Yeah.
And he had a little trivia question, which I don't know if anybody else did it, but I just went and Googled it real quick and then sent it to him. I'm pretty sure most people did that.
I didn't, and I got it wrong.
I got it. I think I got it right, but anyway, if I get it, we'll just donate it on the.
I think he's already picked a winner.
Oh, has he?
I think he has.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
I think I think so.
Well, while you look that up, there was a contest, but didn't he have another contest going?
I don't know.
Well, we'll get that on the next podcast. So, I guess
we got any other news. Do we want to say who our listener of the week?
Why don't you go for that one?
Okay. For the past week, we chose
Nico,
who is she's been on the forums for a while, and she was actually the one that did the female classes that we talked about really early on in the podcast, and she's continued to do some art. She actually made a devil turnip for me in
that
her
awesome.
Art style, and it's freaking amazing. So she's been for the last week, she's been our player of the week, and this next week
she burninates and plays red a lot.
She burns everyone and always plays red.
So
this week who is it?
It's Mint Condition.
Mint Condition. Dun, dun, dun. Yay.
And do you know why it's Mint Condition?
Why?
I mean, I don't even have to say anything. All I have to do is
he still in the wrapper?
I just have to send or start playing this clip that he sent in. Genius. Here it is.
Hi, guys. This is Mint Condition, and I just wanted to drop you a note and let you know that your Christmas episode was a big hit around here. Well, at least it was with my kids. My wife is still kind of confused that they're running around singing about spies sapping their sandwiches. So anyway, they wanted to record this and send it along to you, and I hope you enjoy it as much as they enjoyed producing it, and know that you've given them many hours of hilarity as they run around singing about spies sapping sandwiches and people getting hit by rail cars. That one went over well with my wife also. Just thought you should know. Anyway, thanks a lot for the podcast, thanks a lot for the Christmas episode, and we'll be seeing you around the server. Thanks.
Hi, Control Point. This is Jack, Abby, and Josh. We really liked your Christmas songs. Spy, zapping my sandwich. Spy, zapping my sandwich.
Oh, I forgot to mention, we're not exactly the Von Trapp family.
What sick man sends babies to fight me?
Thank you, Jack, Abby, and Josh,
for that.
That was awesome. That made all of our days.
Yeah, it really was. And thank you to Mint Condition's wife for putting up with it.
Yeah.
It's very seldom that I can convince my wife that I'm doing anything other than just, you know, wasting her time and my time by doing all this.
Oh, yeah.
And when I played that for her, she smiled so big.
Did she tear up a little?
No.
I'm getting some chills just thinking about
it.
Really?
I kind of teared up. That was awesome. And thank you a lot, Mint Condition, by the way. for that. I'm still thinking about that.
Made our day, yeah.
And for
you know what? When I heard it, my shriveled up heart grew 10 times as big, and I gained the strength of 10 Grinches and all that.
While we were listening to that, I did look it up. The question was, what was Arthas's sword?
Oh, this is Mija Wynn contesting?
Right. And the answer was
Frostborn.
Close.
I said Ashbringer.
No, it's not Ashbringer. It's Frostmourne.
That's right.
Yes. Okay. And the winner of the contest was
Chaos.
Little Jimmy.
Oh,
Little Jimmy.
Yep. Holy crap. Should we play what Little Jimmy gave us this week?
Not yet.
Okay. We'll get to that.
Any other things in the news? I think we're done. Hey, this week.
Oh, wait. Oh,
hold on.
Oh, my God. they released the name of the new map that's, that they're making.
One of the maps.
One of the maps, which yes. is going to be Badlands.
Badlands, which is a remake of a Team Fortress classic map.
And yeah, Team Fortress. It was Fortress. Back in Team Fortress.
Was it? 1, okay. 2. I'm hearing lots of people complain that it's not actually going to be Badlands and, you know, whatever.
Get over it. It's going to be fun. Badlands was a good map.
New map's good.
Have some faith in these guys.
I didn't like the Badlands zone in World of Warcraft, though.
That has absolutely nothing to do with our current conversation, yeah. but thank you for bringing that up. Anyway, this week in our map segment, which is called, I don't remember, someone tell me.
Reconnaissance.
Yay, this week the map of choice is
Dustbowl.
Which is a bowl full of dust.
Okay, we actually had a lot of debate on how to frame this episode. We talked a lot about it at the beginning about, well, do we want to do it class by class? Do we want to do it level by level? And really, the only way I could think to do it without creating some cognitive interference with trying to understand multiple places on multiple levels of multiple maps is to go basically stage by stage. However, there are some basic concepts that will work in all stages of Dust Bowl, and I'd like to talk about them first.
Hey, Wes?
Yes.
What are some basic tips that you can use on all stages of Dust Bowl?
Well, first off, since the capture points are so close and essentially right near the spawns of the attackers, it's very important to recognize that managing Ubers is a significant part of the start of the game. Every time each level starts, there will be an Uber going off from the offensive as long as they've got medics, and unless your defense handles it properly, they're just going to go forward until they meet opposition, activate the Uber, and take out your sentries, and then capture your point. So the trick is to understand when to use the Ubers and how to defend against the Ubers. The key for offense is to recognize that your ideal situation is to get to right before where the sentries are going to be placed, pop it, take them out, and then use it to clear out the area. On defense, the trick is going to be there. You want to pop your Uber second so that when theirs is over, yours is still up and you can still kill them. And the second thing is you really want to make sure that they have a reason to pop the Uber as far away from the control point as possible.
I think that there are different ways to go about it that work equally as well. I've seen a lot of people use an Uber right off the bat and get in and just basically crush an initial rush and cause the defensive team to waste their Uber defending against the other Uber.
And I think that comes up with probably one of the best strategies is to get two Ubers going and come out trying to get them to pop theirs and pop yours, but keep one in the cave away from any danger until that's done, and then pull them up for getting into the first cab.
I'm a big fan of illegal street racing, and it's sort of like, when do you use your nitrous burst? Yeah. I know when I'm in my little Toyota Celica, I pop my nitrous last.
I think there is actually an art to this. I think that watching how the defense is set up will show you when you need to pop your Uber on attack. I mean, if you're up against, you know, five demos and the ground in front of the, you know, the initial setup point is just littered with stickies.
You're going to send out, and
I'll do that sometimes. I'll send somebody out first just to take the hit. But additionally, if they're smart, they'll have multiple sets there and they're waiting, you know, for the big stuff to come through, and popping your Uber is going to be the way to do it. On defense, and specifically, I'm thinking a lot about stage two when I talk about this. I think that's where Ubers are some of the most important when you come out of that
trench.
Yeah. When you come out of that trench.
The trench of doom.
Yes. I have found that when defending, and this is going to go to one of my later points as well, you need to set up more than one sentry zone.
Oh, absolutely.
Because what happens is if you focus your sentries too much, they'll pop the Uber around both of them. The attackers will pop the Uber around both of them and destroy all your sentry outposts. But if you put up one sentry one place and then another farther down that they can't reach with the same Uber, you've essentially made them use their Uber to kill the one sentry and left them vulnerable to the second.
Yeah, and that's another good point about the engineers. I think it's really good to have if you only have two main engineers or three main engineers, always have one extra engineer as kind of a front placement that's always putting a sentry gun in an odd place that gets them to burn that Uber ahead of time. And it also surprises them when they're coming out for these guns and all of a sudden one shooting them from behind.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Now, going hand in hand with this usage of Uber thing, pushes in Dust Bowl are really, really dependent upon having Ubers in your bag and using them in coordination with pushes. One heavy and one medic is not going to open everything up so that you can capture a point. What they are going to be able to do is take out the sentry or in maybe a couple of players. But if an area, and then I'm thinking specifically on stage two on the second cap point, you're going to need more than just your Uber offensive character.
That's a tough point to take, but let's get on with general tips here.
But I know what I'm talking about though is when you have that Uber ready to go, what you want to do is try to coordinate with the other people that are on your team and make sure that they are attacking as well so that you're not just using your Uber for a little bit of personal glory and taking a sentry from level 3 to level 1 again.
Yeah. I think also a good thing with that is don't have everybody attack there. You want to keep a little bit there to keep them down from rebuilding those sentries too if your attack does not go through.
Right.
Because I think that's a big thing is I see a lot of people, they do this one push and then it fails and then they sit back until they've got to wait till the next one, and that just gives them time to build these sentries back up to level 3, and then you just repeat what you did.
Right.
And what you need to do is get people in there, and you know your specific goal at that point is not to cap the point. It's to kill the engineers and the sentries and keep them gone until this next round is ready to come in and take the point.
Yes, absolutely. The third point that I want to bring up for general map theory is there is a discussion on all the maps about a scout or a spy proceeding to the second capture point of every leg of Dust Bowl in order to make that easy cap on the second one. Now I'm 50-50 on this. I think it's a waste of a perfectly good player to have them sitting on the cap point for a good chunk of the game.
I agree, but I also think they can be back there doing other things, getting rid of the sentries.
True, but at the same time, I think that if you don't ever do it, the other team gets lazy. So I really believe in a 50-50 sort of thing. 50% of the time, make sure you've got somebody on that second cap point so that they stay on their toes. Otherwise, keep your unit back so that you're actually using it on your offensive push.
Well, there's an intrinsic value just having that person back there, though, just intel. I mean, that's another thing that a lot of people don't realize spies are good for, not just destroying a sentry or capping a point, but saying, hey, they're building this. Hey, there's a sniper waiting. Hey, there's this. Letting everybody know what they're running into. Right. Ahead of time, and you know, based on what's there, they can make a decision on if they need to bring a gun down or just wait on the point.
That's a good point. Number four, and there might be a couple of other classes you might want to bring up though on this if you guys have any input, but the tunnels in Dust Bowl are like a pyro's wet dream. this is a web work of ambushy style little things that are specifically designed for a class like this.
And Demoman.
I disagree.
Those are the two classes that I see as really good defenders in there. Pyros, because of their ability to suppress attackers and kill people quickly, and Demoman for their ability just to cause confusion. It works really well, and it's something that I see happen a lot. Now, as far as killing people, pyros are going to take the cake there, but I think demomen are still the only problem
with demomen in those caves is that for you to actually see someone, if you were to sticky up the hallway, I can see how that would be very useful. Using your grenades as suppression ability, keeping people back and things like that, I can see that.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
But they're going to, it's easy to rush past a bunch of grenades sitting on the ground.
Yeah, and I'm not talking about, yeah. Again, it's not effective at killing people, but when you see a stream of grenades flying in, then that's going to cause you to look at that exit and go, maybe I should go a different way. And it's one way of doing that.
So anyway, my point is that it doesn't hurt to have one of your team members whose sole job is to run around in these, especially a pyro is a great op. It's easy kills, easy points. Just do circles in these tunnels. And all you're there to do is flame these people who come around a corner and end up face to face with your flamethrower.
As a heavy player, yeah. I have to say that always infuriates me. But
in pretty much all three stages, what's good about that is there's a good way to get behind the enemy lines and come behind them where they're not expecting you and tear up their forces.
True. Mm-hmm. And that brings mm-hmm. me to point number five. I think that on defense, you need to harass the attackers as much as possible.
Don't sit back and wait for them to come to you. Be aggressive. Go after their spawn and
get
and
a pyro.
Kill their medics.
I mean, it's very frustrating. You know, when people first come out of this, people first come out of the spawn and they get shot. it's very disruptive towards the idea of moving smoothly towards the battle. You end up harried. You end up looking around every corner. It causes a lot of confusion. And if you can get some people back towards the spawn to harry the attackers before they even get to the front lines, you've done a great job.
Right. And this is the only map where that's really set as big a deal as it is, because the only other offense defense non-custom map is gravel pit and really, unless I've seen people get in there, but they don't do a whole lot of good. Usually they get up in those little tunnels and they die very quickly.
It's harder to harry the spawn on hydro and on gravel pit.
Well, this isn't gravel pit discussion.
Okay, no, moving on.
I disagree with that.
It can be done. Okay, the last point I'd like to bring up as a general Dust Bowl theory is that teleporters are extremely important on this level. Because the lines are so close to the attacker spawn at the beginning and so far away and so close to the defender spawn at the end, the balance of power on those two stages can be swiftly altered by a couple of deaths where you can't replace the forces fast enough.
Yeah, I'd almost say it's almost more important to get a teleporter up than it is to get that second sentry up.
I think I agree with you.
I am a heavy and I approve this message.
I'm kind of losing my train of thought, but
teleporters.
But that respawn time, getting, you know, when the attack, like on the trench on section two, if you can get a teleporter inside that building underneath the capture point, then you can get forces from, you know, that cuts off, you know, 15 seconds of travel time, and that'll get people back into the battle quick enough so that they can, you know, that they can do some real damage.
Yeah.
Okay, so now I guess let's move on to the individual stages.
Oh, I had another point.
Oh.
I've noticed a lot of times playing Dust Bowl, all three stages, there's usually sentry farms. Usually you don't just have one in one area, you'll have two or three. In every single stage it happens. And the tip here is for a pyro to guard that farm. There's no sense in guarding every single sentry laying around, but it's commonplace in Dust Bowl to have two or three all lined up. So sacrifice one pyro, and we do this a lot during our clan practice. We'll have one pyro standing there doing 360s with his fire going and standing next to a dispenser. You don't run out of ammo. And so you're killing all the spies, or spies will see that and they won't go for it. It's very effective.
Fire bad. Fire bad.
Napster good. Oh, wait.
But anyway, so.
Okay, so moving on, we've got stage one. Now, stage one is the part of Dust Bowl where the attacking team starts off in a cave with three exits. The defending team starts off.
Three exits?
Three. Yep.
Yeah.
Really?
There is the one on the left. It's the slight ramp up.
Yeah.
There's the one in the middle, which goes to the bottom of the chasm.
Big opening.
And then there's one to the far right that comes out on the other side.
Holy crap. I had no idea.
What?
I did not know about that
it's
one.
It's a tiny little thing, and it's a long hallway, and it
is vitally
out.
Important.
It empties out right
I
next to a guard
I had no
shack.
Idea. Oh, my God.
There's a health kit in there. There's an ammo kit in there, and then a little guard shack.
Next time I give anyone any TF2 advice, just say, you didn't know about the third exit of the first Dust Bowl. What the hell's wrong with you?
It took me a little. It's kind of tricky. It's not like the other two exits. When you appear, you got to kind of turn immediately to the right and go over that way to get to
it. And it's a long walk.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I think I found it when, you know, we lost and I had to find a place to hide. And I was like, hey, what's this hallway?
Now, I actually think that third exit is vitally important.
I love it.
Because if you can get someone through there to harass the defenders that are on top of the shack next to that far left exit, then you've given them another front to worry about. Mm-hmm. And as a demo man, a lot of times I will run over there and hope that me and whoever goes with me can clear out the defenders from right there, and then I can lob grenades over and really help the offense coming out the main exit.
That's just a general offensive tip too. The more fronts you can create that the defense has to worry about, the better off you are. So
I have yet to see a good reason for coming out the trench.
Oh, I have.
Me too.
It's great.
I have yet to see a good reason to do it.
Especially, almost everyone always goes out that far left. Am I right? Left side.
By the way, when we give directions today, we're going to try to do it on the terms of the attacker.
Right. So if you're coming from the attacker spawn, it's the one on the left. That's the most used exit from my experience. That's where most people pop out. And a lot of times, it depends on where the defenders have their turret set up, but the trench is a good place just to pop out and harry that shack there that you're talking about. And plus, it's an easy place to get some quick sniper kills.
See, most people, one thing is, though, most people, now that they know about the third exit, choose that as the not the left exit.
Well, that's fine, because I found that middle trench exit is very rarely heavily defended.
One thing it is good for is for running. If you can manage to hug that left wall, you can pop up right there at the rear exit from the spawn point, and you can throw a bunch of grenades and stuff in to mess with the defenders who were standing on the spawn point.
Yeah, I'd say that would probably be a good exit for spies.
I've seen a lot of spies use that exit.
That's a good point.
Pyros shooting up over the lip.
Yep.
And Demo Man shooting up over there.
Honestly, heavies can put down a lot of suppressive fire.
You have changed my mind about that exit.
And I use it as a soldier a lot of times, because I think going through the front door is the worst way to go into that shack. I think either coming around the back door or rocket jumping up onto the ledge.
From the top. Yeah.
That's a good point.
And that's another good point about all these maps. There's windows everywhere, and there's sentries behind those windows almost all the time. So use your long range and rockets and get it through those windows, and you're going to kill something and usually clear out a point without ever being in danger even.
Yep.
Now, on this point, getting out of that far left entrance and into the control point is usually pretty tricky. There is almost always at least one sentry that defenders will build in that check where the control point is. A lot of times it'll be to the immediate
stairs.
Right on the stairs, and that's a good place if you've got people defending it. If you don't have a whole lot of people in that room, I think that on that back mine car area is better, because you get a little bit more distance and the pyros can't kill the sentry as fast.
Yeah, that's kind of a little bridge or a catwalk, I guess, right?
Yeah, that would be a catwalk. would be a catwalk.
Well, when you first walk
not a boxy catwalk.
No.
The other...
more rail-y.
The other sentry placement is kind of on an elbow, right? I mean, it kind of is, right? I mean, it's halfway up the stairs. Anyway.
Spencer's steaming. There's steam shooting out his ears.
Use those terms.
A lot of times, some other people will build them actually like in the cave entrances there, going into the tunnels. Right. And what that'll do is it'll keep people from that are turning to the left and trying to kind of strafe up into the control area. They won't look over and see those sentries, and they'll get hit by them.
All right.
Which is a good place to, right behind the shack on cap one, there's just a little cubby hole, which is good for a teleporter exit and a gun.
Yep.
And this will do two things. One, you've got a guarded teleporter. And the next thing is, after they cap that point, because let me tell you, they probably will, they'll be running out and run by there and not even think there's going to be a sentry until they listen to this podcast, and they'll get blown up and they'll die.
Yeah.
And your forces will be teleporting in and being able to harry them right away.
Now, this is something that I see happen a lot that I wish would change from the defender's point of view. After that first point is taken, they stop harrying those hallways altogether. Defenders typically fall all the way back to the next point. Mm-hmm. Now, that next point is very easy to defend if you've got if you've got your stuff together. it takes time off the clock if you, again, have a pyro running around in those hallways or have some sentries built in the hallways that will just slow the defenders down and run down the clock, because your clock will carry over from leg to leg.
I actually think that the second point on stage one is the hardest point to defend in the entire game.
And I think that there are a lot of points of attack that you can take, but there are some good places.
Two on stage, on leg one.
I understand where you're coming from, because there's an exit. There are at least three exits that you can get right up close to the point very
quickly. And
there's
partial shielding from various directions.
Right.
Once that sentry is gone, and let's lay out the thing here. We've got once you take cap point one, there is a rail pathway that goes up into a mine shaft to the left of the capture point. Mm-hmm. Additionally, the tunnels go to the right. And a lot of times after the exit of those tunnels, there's a silo sort of looking thing, and people put a sentry there, and that will guard point two. Mm-hmm. Once that sentry's down, I think it is dirt easy to capture that capture point.
Let me tell you what's better than a sentry there.
What?
And I have found this 90% of the time. This has a huge suppressive effect on the enemy. A heavy and a dispenser is far superior.
I agree with you.
Or have dispenser the heavy.
Dispenser. Dispenser.
Right at the bottom of
dispenser
that ramp.
Right here.
Right at the bottom of the ramp next to the control point.
Right.
If you drop a heavy, a pyro, and a dispenser, and they stay there, and you have someone guarding against demo men up at that top, they cannot use that entrance.
Absolutely agreed.
They cannot use that entrance. And that means the only way into the spawn, into the control point, is that front entrance, which the heavy still has full ability to turn and shoot them there.
Right.
Not only that, but those X. What are you doing? Oh, I wasn't talking into the mic. I'm sorry.
He's getting plenty of volume.
Finally, if you have those sentries up by the grain tower or
the
silo,
then that covers that entrance. So it is hard to defend, but it's not impossible to defend.
No, I don't think it is. But I think of all the capture points. So when you talk about people falling back quickly from point one to point two too quickly, I disagree. You can't fall back fast enough, in my opinion. Because now I know a lot of people will disagree with me on this, but defending that second control point from the offense that has just grabbed the first cap point, they're steamrolling. And you have immediately, once that point gets captured, everybody needs to make a beeline.
Well, I mean, that's a problem of people putting all of their defense eggs in one basket, which is a problem on all of them.
That's true.
You should not have all of your defenders at the first cap point. You should have defenders in the back ready to take that initial steamroll rush. Because if you break that steamroll rush, then it becomes a slug fest for the offense. And that's what you want. You want to run down the clock.
Right. Mm-hmm. Oh, crap. I forgot what I was going to say. Oh, as a defender, I think that sending people up into that far left mine shaft where the rails are.
Where the grate is?
Yes.
One-way grate?
Yes. It is extremely important to harry that tunnel.
Yes.
Because that is a prime build-up spot, and you've got to make sure that they never get comfortable there.
Yep.
Yeah, if you're a pyro, go to cap one and come up that way. Yeah. Or try to sneak in when they send someone out.
This is a great sniper spot. If a sniper keeps an eye on that grate and pops people when they come out, it has a huge chilling effect on the offense.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And if you're a soldier or demo, pipe or rocket jump up in the – there's an entrance – still in the second cap point area that you can jump up to. It's the second door over from the grate, or the first door over from the grate.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And you can jump up, and people usually aren't expecting that.
Nope, not at all.
But the end result of this is that the offense is probably going to take the point, and you're going to move on to leg two.
Yes.
think we can agree.
For the most part, I think this is the hardest leg to defend. Totally. And I think that second cap point is the hardest one to defend in the game. Now, one other thing that I note is people will come up through the tunnels when they're attacking and then take a right and go up onto that right landing that's kind of around the corner from the silo.
I don't like that.
I don't like it either, but people will go up there. As a demo man, I try to harry that area with lots of grenades. I can throw them over the boxes, and they roll down the stairs into the caves.
I think that's exit for a spy to go
That's true, because it's the least covered, because most people don't use it, because when most people go out, they die.
And you can jump out and get the sentries faster that are almost always placed on the other side.
Have y'all found any real, other than being a sniper, have you found any real use for those, that backspace, you know, those raised areas that are above the spawn? Have you?
You can probably do pretty good suppressive fire up there. I tried putting a sentry up there, kind of guarding the other sentry one time, and it didn't really seem to do well. No one killed it, but it didn't seem to get it. It's not enough distance to cover the point, so really it's just if a spy uncovers or something.
Right.
Yeah, I see snipers up there a lot.
Yeah,
We've been doing a lot of defense tips here. The best offense tip that is possible here is you want a big push. You don't really need to worry about holding people back, because a big push will typically break the defenders. If you're going out one at a time, you're going to get shot by a turret. You're going to get shot by anyone. Yeah, you got to do a big push to get that point.
And coordinate with your spies on those pushes.
Yes, I mean, got to get those sentries down.
There's nothing like, I mean, a spy can run in and get a sentry stop for a few seconds, but if there's no push, it's pointless.
You know, that's one of the things I wanted to mention. I keep meaning to mention it every show, is you don't have to wait for the sentry to explode to do your push. You have to wait for the spy to sap the sentry.
Yes.
Once the sentry is sapped, if you send enough people in, the engineer is going to freak out and not know what to do, and the sentry is going
to
die.
And it's so much easier to kill a sentry when it's sapped.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're not really healing it when they're unsapping it.
And plus, you can resap it, and you can keep the sentry down while the push is going on, you know, and you're reducing the fire.
And most of those things, once you're in the cap point, it's blocked enough that the sentry is not going to hit you as well.
So once the offense has taken point two on leg one, you move on to stage two or leg two.
I'm sorry. One last point on stage one. I didn't even realize we went to stage two in the first one, and so it was too late to say it. But one good thing about the starting area at point one, stage one, is the resupply cabinet. You can shoot out the doorway, and as a soldier, when you're backed up against one of these things, you don't reload. Nope. So you continuously shoot rockets, and you can keep a nice suppressive fire. And if you jump right, you can actually aim and almost get into the building. So it's just a nice place to sit.
Nice.
That's good tip.
I really, and one other comment, and then we'll move on, because Spencer's being our taskmaster today. Get us moving. I really, that right side is really good. If you can get a couple of people to go out that right exit behind that building and clear it out, it's really good for keeping the snipers and the soldiers and stuff that are on the ledges around the building, around the cap point. You can really keep their activity down. I have found, though, that if you come out and stand visibly where the gate's going to open and there are people out there, and they see you, then they will be prepared for you, and they will start like laying down defenses and getting stuff ready to go. So what I will do is I won't go around the corner, and I'll get everyone who's playing with me to stay right back, and we don't want to make any emotes or, you know, do any cheers, mate, or anything like that to let them know we're back there. Because sometimes what'll happen is people will come over to defend that point, but when they don't see anybody in the door, they'll start pondering how they can help defend the other exit.
Right.
So a little bit of subterfuge and silence might do you some good there. And then we can move on to stage two.
When the offense takes point B of stage one, they spawn in the next map in the defender's spawn room and move on to part two, which has one of my favorite places in the entire zone, the trench.
Yes, the trench is almost universally looked at as one of the bloodiest places in all of Dust Bowl.
And this is my very first Dust Bowl experience was actually in TFC. I never played it in the original Team Fortress because all I played was 2-Fort. back when everyone had grenade spam, that trench was just, oh man, it was brutal.
I can't even imagine.
It was brutal.
I cannot even imagine.
I mean,
did they have Ubers back then?
No Ubers. They were just grenades and special grenades, and then someone would die, and there would be more grenades after they respawned. And
I can't even imagine it making it through there.
You run down and die. That's what happens.
So
anyway, on to the actual game that we're playing now.
Stage 2.1. There are two exits from the trench. And I, you know, as an attacker, I think what I do is I move back and forth between the two of them to see which one's going to be the most heavily defended and then try to run out the one that isn't. Usually there will be a bunch of sticky bombs in front of the door. They will blow you up. Mm-hmm. Usually there will be a bunch of sticky bombs shortly away from the door and they will blow you up and there will be a whole lot of death.
This spot is one of the best places for the defense to shut the offense down completely.
Yes.
Because if you have one or two pyros just running around in that trench, killing the defenders before they can get a push going. If you have a medic with a Uber ready in case they come out with an Uber to shut that Uber down. If you've got, and this is one of my least favorite tactics, but I got to mention it because it's really effective. If you've got four demo men pouring fire into the trench, then there's not really much that the defenders Mm-mm. can do about it.
Mm-mm. They're going to be half to a quarter health before they come out.
Yeah.
Because they're going to have to run over those grenades and just suffer the consequences. If you can get a couple of pyros to push the attackers back far enough so that they're harrying them coming out of the spawn, you have, and then you get people, you give the engineers time to set up to guard against people coming out. They have to pop their Ubers as soon as they come out of their spawn. They're never going to make it to the control point, and you can really do a lot of damage here.
But once they get out of there, it's a little bit tougher.
Yes. And it's not that hard for them to bust out. It can be done. I've seen it done very, very effectively.
Now, one thing that I've seen defenders do wrong is pay so much attention to the trench that they don't pay attention to the few that sneak out and go and cap the point behind their back. So be careful about that if you're defending.
There are two focuses on defense here. Keeping people in the trench and dying and making sure that anybody who has gotten through does not have the ability to easily cap your point. So you want to make sure everybody's Ubers are popped. You do not want them getting up onto that ledge with an Uber ready to take out the sentries that are protecting the control point. Coming as a defender, I find that there are two very important sentries on this level. One is on the building above the trench. If you look on the left, usually there'll be an engineer building a sentry up there. It's not going to live. Nobody expects it to live. It's there solely to make sure that scouts and stuff can't run by so that people have to pop their Ubers in order to destroy it.
And that's why there's a lot of ammo right there underneath it. You can jump down and grab.
There are a couple of places that I really like to put turrets there. If you go up behind the control point, there's some tires stacked up. And if you do it right, you can set up a turret on right next to the control point where you're completely covered by the wall and you can have a dispenser right next to you completely feeding you. So you're completely safe except from Demo Man, and you have a turret that, while very, very easy to shoot, you can keep it going pretty easily. So
that's nice.
I like that.
Another very important sentry that I think is in the doorway facing the control point.
Yes, absolutely. That's one of the best ones.
It is easy to defend, except against Ubered Pyros.
Yeah.
And it provides a very valuable second
line of defense.
Yeah, second line of defense. One of my favorite things to do as a demo man, also, there's a tiny alley. As you're attacking that building, most people will go up on the right side, but it's a very tiny alley with some stacked up boxes at the end of it on the left side. And people will run in there, and it's actually not that easy to do it unless you sticky jump or rocket jump. You got to kind of do the jump crouch thing and to get up the boxes. As a demo man, I consider it to be very important for me to have that whole alleyway stickied and make sure that there are grenades going down that thing the whole time. Additionally, if I arc it high enough, I can get it into the right-hand trench entrance. I can drop grenades down in there. And that allows me to cover both lines of defense from one point.
Wow. There's a multitasker.
Another one in that building that's good is the bunker part of it down below. I love being there as a soldier, and you can put fire down both tunnels as they're coming up, and you'll see them trying to Uber back in the right tunnel, and you can just sit there, and when a crit goes in there and kills two medics, oh, it's a nice day.
I consider it very important as a demo man to make sure that entire room is filled with grenades.
Yep.
On the bunker.
On the offense?
Yeah. If I'm on offense, that's part of my job is emptying out that bunker.
And if you are on offense and you manage to get through the trench and you need a breather, that little hut there is a good place. There's some health and some ammo there to sort of get your bearings. and before you go out on push, because most of the time pyros will be focusing on the trench, and they're really effective in that area, but most of the time you won't run into many pyros, so you can get an Uber going before you go out to take the point or other things as well.
There's also an office building in the back of this area, which I love is the third tier engineer. As you walk into the building, on your left, there's a small room that you can set a sentry up in the back, well, in the corner next to the window, facing back towards the silo where usually there's a sentry. That's an awesome place because no one really ever sees it. It kind of shoots past the wall a little bit.
That's good.
So when people get close by it, but what it's really good is when they cap that point and they start filing past that thing and it's just like a line of deaths. Yeah. And then they're trying to get in there. Oh, it's so much fun. But also get a teleporter in there or behind that building to help with the getting troops up there.
Yes. And that sentry will do another thing is, you know, the fallback after the first capture point, it'll allow the engineers who have died and are respawning time to get their first and second level sentries up mm-hmm. while the team is still dealing with the remnants of having captured the first point.
Right. Mm-hmm. So are we done with point A?
We're done with point A. Okay. Let's move on to point
B. Once you move on to point B, this is, in my opinion, the hardest the easiest defense, the hardest offense point in the map, in my opinion. Point B on stage two, I see more offenses get shut down here than anywhere else.
I agree.
It's very easy to defend. There are really only two places for the offenders to come in from the point. There really are three. I mean, there's one from the second level. You can come in through that, but you're going to get shot by the same guy who's going to shoot you if you come in from the first level or around the side of the building.
Yes.
There's a very few number of entrance points. And God, how many sentry farms have there been there? I wonder. You think it's 8 million? 8 million sentry farms?
Yeah. I think
so. It's sentry heaven, and a spy, there's only so much a spy can do.
Especially with
the pyro standing right there, and you got demo men covering the point and throwing grenades, and then meanwhile you've got some heavy jerkwad that's standing on top of the entrance to the whole zone shooting you when you come in, and you've got pyros in those tunnels killing you before you even get there. So this is where the game usually gets shut down.
Yeah, and I think one of the things you need to do to get through that is at least three Ubers, where you're using one to just get rid of the guns, and then the two coming in once those guns are down right behind it, and then taking the point, and then everybody else filing in.
And defending that, the grate is at the end of a very long tunnel, a crooked tunnel, kind of an elbow again. Sorry for that term, but it is an elbow.
It hurts.
One pyro needs to clean out that area. Once that pyro dies, the next time you spawn, a new sentry will be up. So so just continuously have one pyro go and clean out that tunnel. He'll need a medic too. So one medic, one pyro. We did that during clan practice, and it's awesome because
I will, as a demo man, I will try to get into that hallway before anyone else gets there. And what I will do is I will sticky the whole thing.
Oh yeah.
And then I'll just dump grenades down so that they rest at the end of the hallway whenever anybody tries to come in. Now I'm particularly vulnerable to people with long range weapons. Mm-hmm. So like soldiers and even shotguns can cause me problems. But I can at least keep them from building anything up in there by keeping the hallway sticky. And I'll die two or three, you know, once for every two or three kills that I get there.
Right. So that's good to prevent the building. But if the building is already commenced, then you need a pyro and a medic to clean it out.
Because that as an attacker, that is a good forward point because it's easy to defend. You build a teleporter exit there, you build a dispenser there, and you get a sentry there, and you've got that tunnel. You've got a nice and then you've got a one-way door that when the people are ready, they can just plow out and try to make their attack from one of any of the two directions.
Yeah, and one courtesy tip about that one little area, when someone's walking out of the grate, you know, it's a one-way door, so I hate when I see two people walk out of the door simultaneously. One person needs to let one walk through just in case he needs to walk back, because if two people go through the door and one decides they want to go back, well, there's no going back. You're dead.
Yep.
You know, so it's always nice to have one person kind of trail behind to let them back in.
And that also helps the defenders because it leaves the door open a little longer so that a pyro can run in and kill the sentry.
Yeah, that's the other thing with the grate. If you're building Ubers back there, stay away from the grate. There's nothing like having someone walk by the grate, open it up, and then do them and get six stickies in there and kill everybody.
Yep.
Yeah.
But there's two other places. The Long Mining Tunnel, which is on the right side of the office building, as you're coming out to it.
Yes.
On your left, as you're going to point to, it's a long tunnel that leads out behind kind of a rock if you follow the wall.
Yep.
It's probably the least used exit. And I think it's one of the best places to push because if you get behind that rock, you can take out those sentries without being hit by them. Mm-hmm. So, and there's a big health pack back there too. So if you go that route, I think you can do a lot of damage.
Very interesting.
As a demo man, I'll stand behind the big boulder, okay, the big rock, and I will creep to the right until I've got kind of a V made from the rock and the building there. And if I lob my grenades right over that, they will land in the sentry farm almost every single time, and I can just dump
as a defender or
as an attacker.
As an attacker, I think defending that rock is a fool's game.
Really?
Yeah, I do. I think you go in there to clear out attackers once they're there, but attackers don't. It's not a good jump off point because there's too many ways for them to get killed from there.
I like to again as a demo man. I can even stand at the sentry farm and do the opposite, which is I take four grenades and I space them so that they fall behind the rock and it just hurts whoever's back there. Now there's a full med pack back there. It'll give you 100% health,
but not to everyone.
Right. Exactly. So you can, and plus once people see those grenades start coming down, they start going, and run.
Okay. So if you are attacking and you manage to punch through some pretty impenetrable defensive tactics that can be done there, then you move on to stage three, which I think is my favorite stage.
That's my favorite too.
Yep. Is it your favorite, Wes?
It is. It is indeed.
So how many of us think that's our favorite?
Three of four at least.
We didn't hear I think it's
everyone
my
say I, it's my favorite.
It's my favorite.
Yay, stage three. Now stage three.
Not stage three, point A is not quite my favorite.
No. Point A is usually over very quickly.
Yeah.
Unless you follow these tips.
If it lasts a long time, the first part of stage three is just nightmarish.
It's another one of those places where a competent defense can really stymie the offense, and it's really frustrating because I don't really ever see any reason why it's so hard. But there's
sentries.
There's multiple places to put sentries.
The unstoppable sentries, I think, is one of the big keys too.
Yeah, there's a series of tunnels that lead from the attacker spawn out to that courtyard area that the defenders can go in and completely screw up my day. Completely screw up my day. I hate that.
You know, stage three with the instant respawn is pretty interesting. Good, because it's always a stalemate and it lasts way too long.
Oh, it's bloody.
But
it's
I like it, you know, because it's lots.
When we were on that 32 man server, the battles at point one of stage three were so dramatic.
And I've never played it with 32 man, but 24 is bad enough. I mean,
are you talking like eight sentries on 32 man?
It wasn't that. It's multiple Ubers, and you're dealing with an Ubered heavy every 30 seconds or so.
That's nuts. That's wacky. That's just wacky.
But if you're on offense and you manage to break through, once you break through, that point is actually really easy to take.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, once the offense gets to the point and has the sentries cleared out, there's nothing the defense can do about it.
No.
It's over.
Yes.
But the defense needs to get back there and treat it like that, like they're still keeping the area, because you can still keep that map safe. Because the goal of the offense, once they kill that, is just to get to the corner. Just to get around there and get to the end of the corner, or they're going to be shut down again down that long hallway.
And, you know, that's something that I saw personally, I think I saw done a lot better in the past. Because most of the time, this is another situation where when that first point is taken, the defenders almost always fall entirely back. And I think that's the wrong move.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you on this one. There is no need to retreat to the second point after the first point is capped here.
Because the second point is right by your spawn. It does not take long to put together a competent defense at the goal line.
Not at all.
Yeah.
And there are much better defense points at the turns in the walkway leading up to your spawn. There it's, you know, on the other maps, the best defense place was right there at the cap point. That's not the case on this map. You get much better defense trying to hold that last turn before the capture point.
Agreed. In fact, one of my favorite things to do with defense is to constantly push the offense back to that.
Yes.
And you don't hold back at the point because there's too many entrances.
Yeah, I say come out the sewers behind them. You'll a lot of times hit someone coming down in your way, but if you can kill them and a few of you come out that way, you can tear them up. Same thing with coming out the back door that a lot of people said sentries up on that ledge. People just aren't expecting, and you can sit up there and put them back there.
Some people don't know about that. When you're spawning as a defender on stage three, there are two spawn rooms.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're coming out of the spawn, one is on the left and one is on the right. The right-hand spawn room has a secondary exit, which goes to a small tunnel, which leads to a ledge above cap point one.
Yep.
If you put a sentry up there, spies cannot get to it. It as long as you keep it healed up, it will do. Now the problem is it's also at a really bad angle for soldiers. So it ends up being soldier fodder, but you don't have to worry about it being sapped, which can be a real pain. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of debate. A lot of people think that you need to keep a teleporter up in there. And what it does is it allows people to teleport up and get behind the enemy lines. I'm not a big fan of it. I don't see much point in it. But then again, I don't play a pyro all that much.
Yeah.
And I think it's a pyro move.
Well, I like it, playing pyro. I like that because they never see you coming. When you come up through the sewers,
right,
you know, into the back, and then you go down the alleyway and burn them from the back. Or you're so close to their spawn, might as well head down to their spawn and keep them busy for a while.
Yeah.
Once you capture point one, the door leading to that little hallway I just described will shut, and it will not open again. So if you've built a teleporter in there before cap point one was there, you can still use it to get units to that same ledge. There is one other secret, and that's what Brent was just, I mean, Eric was just talking about. There is, at the bottom of the trench underneath cap point two, there is a doorway that goes to a long hallway that then leads up to that middle alley.
Yeah.
And it is a good point, a good place. Once the attackers get to that final turn where they're trying to go around the corner straight to the cap point.
Final elbow.
I saw Wes trying not to say that earlier.
it's really good for being behind the lines on that.
Yeah.
You know what one of my favorite tricks is as a heavy? It's not really a trick, but right across as a defender, right across the bridge from the control point, there are those two buildings on either side, and one has a little bunker in the bottom, and then you go up the stairs and you can go out on a little ledge there. You can go around and there's this hallway, sort of open hallway right next to the control point. You guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
If you get a heavy up there, there is a full ammo crate and a full health.
Yes,
right, that's there. Right.
And by yourself, I have done this by myself. I have managed to hold that corner for up to 3 minutes because I have a perfect field of fire. And the only way they can get to me without dying is by jumping, and I get to shoot them the whole way. So it's a lot of fun.
There is there's a couple of key little points in that map that some people don't know about. For instance, as an attacker, as you come around the corner from the first cap point, there's a ramp. And if you go up it, there's a little area off to the right with a health and an ammo canister. And then there's a little ramp that leads up to a ledge that faces the second turn of the alley where a lot of killing will go on.
Yep.
It is a great place for demomen. I think demomen and soldiers have a great time up there because they can really keep the defenders from coming around the corner and retaking that ledge on the left.
But honestly, it's not that hard, even with soldiers and demomen, because all you have to do is slip through that door and they can't do anything about you.
Okay.
I'm saying that as a heavy who is not good at sneaking, I have managed to slip into that doorway and cause all sorts of havoc, no matter how many defenders are there, because all it takes is that 1 second where you get into the door and they have no fire field on you anymore.
The next is, and Spencer was talking about this a second ago, if you're coming around and you come around the last turn and you're facing the second cap point, There's a little door off to the right, and there's some stairs that go down to a bunker, which I rarely see anyone in there because it's just a big spot
trap.
Of death.
It's a death trap.
I mean,
I see snipers there every once in a while, but question it.
In TFC, it was a lot more useful than it is now.
I think it would be better if it was darker, but it's extremely well lit. You can see anybody who's in there. There's nothing. I mean,
and you're running down that hallway. What else do you got to do with your missiles except for shooting to a hole?
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's like Star Wars coming down the. Anyway.
The Marina Trench.
Stay on target. But if you go up, you come around and you come to a ledge that Spencer was just talking about. There's a full ammo canister and a full health canister there, and you can do a lot of damage from up there. But then if you keep going, it goes around to a long, straight
ledge.
Open.
That
open
comes over the sewers.
Causeway. No. I'm talking about. On the last turn, you're coming in as an attacker. You're on the far right, and the cap point is here.
It looks over the sewers and
it's like a little ledge.
You're saying it looks over the trench.
Yeah.
If you can get a couple of ranged attackers over there, you can really suppress them back to their spawn point. Now it's easy to fend things off to clear that area out, but an infestation of attackers in that area can really inhibit the defense from doing what it's supposed to do.
Spy city is what it is for defenders. Yeah. Spies in.
So yeah, spies are great jumping off that ledge because you can get into the little area behind the control point. I don't know why I'm doing hand motions, but
I'm doing the same thing. I'm going over here on the right.
You got to do a control jump to get over there, but you can still get over there and work your way.
Control jump?
Duck jump?
Yeah.
Oh.
Holding down the control button.
Yeah. but I find as a demo man, that's a particularly good spot is over there. And what I'll do is I'll make sure there's grenades on the capture point for as long as they'll let me throw them. And then I'll run back and get the ammo, come back, and then I just wait for the pyro to come kill me.
This is why this point is fun for me. How many times have you been on defense and feel like you got a pretty good streak going, and then you look up at the clock and it says 17 minutes remaining, and you think to yourself, oh my God, I got to keep this up for another 17 minutes? And then someone inevitably says it, and it's like, yeah, we were just thinking the same thing.
That was me. I'm sorry.
Yeah, thanks.
I think we've been going too long.
But then when you do keep it for 17 minutes, that feeling, that joy, that rush to their spawn room to kill them again.
Yeah, that's fun.
I think we're done.
Yeah.
Are we done?
Do we have any listener tips that we want to go through here?
We've got some stuff, I believe. We're done with Dustbowl, I think, right?
Yeah, well, I did get one contribution. This is from Metal, who is always gives the best contributions.
The very best.
Yes. This one says, do not play this map if you, one, get tired of dying often without ever killing someone. Two, hate having a kills per death ratio less than one. Three, hate teamwork and would much rather prefer to be dragged behind a horse who ate plenty of fiber for breakfast.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Four, blissfully ignore the presence of snipers on the other team. Or five, think that the snipers have a machete.
Nice. Like
it's not a machete.
It's a kukri.
Kukri. God, that'll never die. Next week. Oh, wait, we have some more contributions. Oh, that was it. Okay. Next week, we are doing well.
Yes.
And we did have a call in for Dustbowl, too. We'll play at the end of the podcast.
Yes. Yeah. We got an excellent call in.
Who's that from?
That came from Cardinal.
Cardinal.
And it's pretty lengthy. There's lots of tips. He goes through a whole myriad of tips through all the stages and tips. And
we couldn't think of a good way to edit it down.
Yeah. It's quite long.
Yeah. So
it was good info. So stick around and listen to it.
Yeah.
And are we gonna add the dramatic music?
I am.
For what part?
For his contribution.
Oh.
should we put the
It's an epic tip, so we're going to have some epic music to go along with it.
He did not send it in with the music.
So, and then that's the map talk. We'll do well next week, so send in your tips.
I'm
call
looking forward
in.
To that. I don't play a whole lot of well.
I don't either. I'd like to. I'd like to play new stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
but I'm going to play some more well this week. So, yeah. Yay.
I think the only map I dislike at this point is Granary.
I like Granary. I don't dislike any. Well, okay, Hydro. I'm not a real fan of
what?
Hydro.
I put it back on the cycle, so we'll get to play Hydro more.
Ninja, please.
Hey, we got some listener contributions.
Yeah, how about the good question that this guy, who did not leave his name, but he called in, and this is a good question.
Hey, guys. I was just calling to give a suggestion for a topic you guys should talk about for those of us who don't have the best internet, which is me and my roommate. Lag friendliest class, because we've learned quite well it's not the spy. So talk about it.
All right, thanks a lot. Random person who didn't leave us your name, please leave your name so we can credit you with the question. My answer is the sniper. The sniper is great. All you really have to do is shoot with unerring accuracy, and you're good. So I'd say sniper. Seriously, though, I would say heavy.
Engineer.
Pyro.
I'd say pyro.
Pyro.
Pyro soldier. Or heavy. Because
you're keeping
you
the button down the whole time, and if anybody runs by, they just get flamed.
Medic. Yeah.
Okay, but an engineer, you have a weapon that runs off the server, that's not true. Off your machine.
Yeah.
So you get a gun up, and it's doing its damage. And you might want to play an offensive one or something where you're setting up things and letting them die. But
the heavy's also good. I think that the soldier isn't bad if you're good at playing on a laggy connection. I know that in the old Quake days, some of the best players with the rocket launcher had, 800 ping. Which wasn't unusual back then. So you can get good with pretty much any class. I can see how the spy would be difficult.
Oh yeah, but
stab. Oh, you're not there anymore.
Oh, you can't rocket jump rocket when you're jump lagging.
Would be difficult.
No,
we were trying to upload that Mario Kart, and I was like, why can't I rocket jump? And I would like rocket jump and like never move up.
And then
like
you
just
looked,
blowing
you
myself looked, up and never go anywhere.
You looked at the score sheet and you had something like 500 ping.
But basically, if you want to play on a laggy connection, you just have to try the classes and see what you like best. I'm just like anyone else. So,
and then once you get done doing that, switch to engineer.
Yeah. Boom Rocker from a post on our forum. Is that correct? Is that where it came from?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
What is this he sent? I'm not reading this.
I think you should.
No, it's
well, can you tell us what your FGG is?
No. Oh, okay, yes. I see what we're reading.
FGG. Is that favorite Golden Girl?
I think so.
Okay, he has his MPC, his most played class, I can't believe I just said it, as Soldier. His MEF.
Most eaten food?
Most eaten food is pizza. His LPC, least play class, is Sniper. And his FGG, favorite Golden Girl, is Betty White.
That's everybody's FGG.
No, B. Arthur. No, B. Arthur. I love B. Arthur. I do.
That's true.
Yeah. So thank you very much, Boomrocker. That's great.
I like the one who tries to act sexy all the time. That's my favorite.
Golden Girl trumps your Golden Girl.
My Golden Girl... huge. She could kick
We've
your
got
golden,
golden
girl's
girls
butt.
In spades.
We also
thanks
had
a,
lot.
Thanks a lot.
A tip from Breadhead Fred, which is really funny because we have a good friend here named
Fred that makes bread. So yeah. He's Fred Bread. He makes Fred Bread.
Yeah.
Anyway.
And so maybe it isn't cool. But anyway. And he had a tip for changing your screenshot so you don't have Targa files. Just type in console, bind F5. JPEG.
Oh, I'm going to have to do that.
Or type that into your default.cfg or autoconfig.cfg. That's a script that gets written or executed every time you play the game.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So I have a lot of stuff in my autoconfig because, I mean, there's too much to type once you start playing.
Right.
But that's, I mean, if you just have this one little thing, bind F5 JPEG is really good.
And then besides that, we had another call-in.
Yes, we did.
This one's from Lil Jimmy, and it's sort of a, what would you call this, a tip or an observation?
It's I think it's both.
A question?
I don't know.
Yes. I don't know.
I think it's a combination.
Let's roll it.
Hey, guys. This is Lil Jimmy. I thought you should know that Wes Wilson sounds like a fake name. Okay, bye.
Okay, so that was more of a comment, I guess.
Yes.
I don't know. I think it was a question. I have a question. Wes.
What?
What is your real name?
My full name is Wesley Wade Wilson.
Fake.
You know what's funny? His wife's name is Wendy.
So we're Wes and Wendy Wilson.
They're the WWWs. Isn't that so adorable?
Hacks.
Yeah.
I call hacks on that, Wes.
www.www.com.
I
and they named their son Wrigley Field.
Nice.
Wrigley double mint.
That's awesome.
Wrigley Field Wilson. I actually tried to get, I did get WesWilson.com when I was younger, but if I had been smart, I would have gotten www.com, but I didn't.
Weak.
That would be difficult to get now.
We had, let's see, one other call in here. Didn't we?
We played them all.
Oh, we played it. That's right. Yeah, we played.
Or we'll play it.
Yeah, and just stick around for Cardinals tips at the end of the podcast.
Shout outs.
What's this?
Surveillance. Pixel art. Yeah.
There was pixel art I found on, I think it was DeviantArt or something, but, pixeljoint.com. And it's basically just a picture of a heavy and a scout, pixel art stuff. So we'll put the link in the show notes as always.
There were some other things too in our forums, and I don't have the links handy in front of me.
There was a bunch of great stuff. There was Kirby Fortress.
Yeah, there was the,
that was pretty cool.
That what was that? Was it sort of the sentry thing?
The
what
day
was
in
that?
The life of a sentry.
Day
gun?
In the life of the sentry gun.
Yes, it's a portal humor machinima that is hysterical.
That was funny.
There was also a meet the what was it? Meet the Oh, someone made a...
I didn't see that one.
Oh, well.
Well!
That sounded exciting.
There was a Meet the Nothing that was in there.
Which, while you're busy digging in, you can dig us as well on DIGG.com.
Dig, yes.
And then while you're doing that, pull up iTunes and leave us a review.
Yay! Love iTunes reviews. Hey, Eric.
Yeah.
Do you like iTunes reviews?
I love them.
Yeah.
And then you can go join the community and post your own links that we'll probably pimp out on the show when we're looking for content.
Because we can't be bothered to make up our own content.
And then when you want to leave us that tip, that 10 to 30 second tip.
The golden nugget.
You call us at 256-513-4772.
And leave us a message.
And then here's a goofy skit from Eric.
I burn it eight.
Well, we hope you all have a great week.
Yes. Thank we will see much. You next time. Now that's the podcast over. How did it go?
You are now at the end of another episode of Control Point.
Victory.
Every one of you deserves a medal.
A podcast brought to you by the Dead Workers Party. See the show notes and leave comments for this episode at controlpoint.deadworkers.com or leave us a voicemail at area code 256-513-4772.
Auf Wiedersehen!
Hello, this is Major Wynn giving you a Dustbowl tip for the Scout. All you need to do is go right. When in offense, there's a small exit concealed by a shed. And 9 times out of 10, the defending team will be a bit too preoccupied with the grates and the heavies behind it. All you need to do is double jump over the canyon and make your way through the side door to the capture point, providing there's no, you know, little annoying things like sentries and demo men and eyes as well. They hurt a lot. Yeah. So I'll see you later. Good luck on that. And remember, it's Major, not Major.
Greetings, gentlemen. This is Cardinal. You have a great show, you have great servers, and this is a great community. I'm just calling in with some Dust Bowl tips. Dust Bowl, in my experience, is all about some key defensive points and sentry guns on those points and destroying sentry guns on those points. On defense, you're depending on your sentries for your primary defense, and when you're attacking, your primary tactical objective is to destroy those sentry guns so that you can get on the point. On 2-Fort, you've heard that 3 Angies might be overkill. I think 3 Angies on Dust Bowl defense is the minimum. 4 is a good balance, 5 is overkill. In Stage 1, defense will almost always lose Point 1, and Point 2 is very close by. Sentry guns need to go up on point 2 from the beginning, so when point 1 falls, point 2 is already defended. I've used the tactic many times, I've seen the tactic used many times, where the attackers will send a scout or a spy ahead on point 2 and lie in wait so that when point 1 falls, point 2 falls very, very quickly. So if sentry guns are not already up on that point, they need to be. Because spies are often used in this role, pyro defense on the back side for sentry guns on point 2 is critical. the important places to put the sentry guns on point two include some place that can cover that that point itself. I especially like it to be right next to it, either somewhere near the boxes near point two. And the silo point is another, or right next to that silo, is another very popular place because it can cover pretty much everything else. The problem with the silo point is that it can't cover the point itself. So you can get a fast unit onto there or an Ubered unit onto there, you can be in a lot of trouble. As always, pyros need to keep the sentry guns secure, especially against spies. Critical part of defense on Dust Bowl in general, and this applies to all three stages, is always going to be harassment by mobile defensive combat units. These are your pyros, soldiers, and demo men. Given time, attackers will and should build up Ubers, but they're also going to be using indirect fire from demo men and range, soldiers, and even snipers to take out your sentry guns. By putting forward the combat units, you can disrupt these attacks, you can prevent them from building up Ubers, and you can flank them, especially to prevent them from taking out your sentry guns from range. And when I say flank, what I mean is don't go straight at them. Hit them from their flanks, hit them from the side, hit them from behind. There's lots of tunnels in Dust Bowl and lots of places that you can get behind the enemy lines and really do some destructive damage on them. This is one of my favorite roles in Dust Bowl defense. On Dust Bowl Stage 2, the same principle applies as on Stage 1 for the defensive guys. Set up engineering doodads at point 2 from the start of the round. Again, point 2 is going to be that the area of combat for most of the round. But it's still useful to put sentry guns up on point 1. But you need to make sure that it covers the point, but that it also covers the stairs going up in the building that the point is in. The problem that I've seen from many sentry gun placements is that heavies and pyros can come up behind it because it's primarily on that point and from up the stairs and really do a number on them. On point two, knockback from sentry guns is key to defense. I'd like to put two sentry guns on one side, on the left as you're on defense, to knock back Ubered heavies and pyros that will inevitably come around from that safe area that they have on the left. Well, sort of safe area. If you're harassing them properly, it's not safe. If they're far enough away from the sentry guns, Ubered pyros and heavies do no damage to your sentry guns. Also, make sure to hold the rock cover on the far side from point two. Soldiers and demo men can annihilate your sentry guns from that cover. I like to station a heavy with a dispenser over there if I can. Heck, I like to be the heavy with a dispenser over there if I can. Make sure you have those harassing mobile troops keeping the attackers from building up Ubers as well. Again, harassment is key on Dust Bowl defense for every stage. Attackers on Dust Bowl 2, or on Stage 2, need to have engineering support as well in the form of teleporter or two. An engineering doodad's in that long tunnel on the right to establish that as your base of operation to build up Ubers and coordinate attacks. Pyros doing anti-spy duty can be very helpful here as well if defense notices your setup in this area. Everyone knows Stage 3 is the epic battle for that first corner at the beginning. I'm sure we all have great memories of bottling up the attackers when we're on defense or busting through that defense when we're attacking. Defensive sentry guns can be placed on both sides of the bottleneck, but I prefer to put at least two on the side leading to point two for knockback effect. It's particularly difficult for the attackers to destroy one if you put it in the overlooking shortcut corridor from your spawn. Also, take advantage of the building on the far side overlooking their courtyard with mobile units. You can do some pretty serious damage there with a pyro, demoman, or soldier, or heavy shooting through those windows down at the attackers. And there's health and ammo for you as well. By the way, it's critical for defenders to know about the shortcut from spawn to point 1 on stage 3, at least until point 1 falls when you lose it. I've seen many players run all the way down that huge long corridor from point 2 to point 1, and there's a shortcut from the spawn on the right for defense. It's much faster, so even if you spawn on the left, just pop into the spawn on the right, use the shortcut, you'll get there much more quickly. We all know how important that is to a successful fight. Even when point 1 falls and the shortcut's no longer available, if you put up a teleporter exit in the shortcut corridor, it can still permit this area to be used as a place to flank the attackers from, which I've seen used to great effect. Of course, smart attackers will look for and destroy these teleporter exits by rocket jumping up into the shortcut area, but it's still worth a try. Defense, don't give up on that first corner, even if point one falls. I've seen that corner held until the end of the round, even without the shortcut, if you have good engineers and pyros. Again, harassing the attackers with mobile troops, especially when Ubered, can be invaluable in this defense, especially if the attackers aren't taking advantage of the low road, so to speak, down in that canyon. Defense can go down there with a medic and a pyro or a heavy or something like that, come up the stairs and hit them from behind. These are critical tactics to winning this round. A note on Ubers. The most important thing to remember about an Uber is that the defense against them is time. If you make the enemy blow them before they're ready by harassing them very effectively, you can prevent them from using those Ubers against your sentry guns on defense. This also goes for offense. If you can wait on those Ubers when you've got that startup, you can be very effective in taking out their sentry guns. Basically, in the beginning, you've got the time to build up sentry guns versus the time to build up Ubers. So on offense, you should be building up Ubers. It's not always a bad idea to have five teams of medics and something, pyros, demo men, or heavies, building up from the beginning. And likewise, on defense, it's often useful to get one or two Ubers to go in there and make them pop all of their Ubers, because usually they're not coordinating them. So if you send in an Ubered pyro, all five of those might blow. So again, coordination, communication is key. The attacking commander might want to say, you two, if they Uber, you guys take care of them, bottle them up, while the other three go and kill the sentry guns, that sort of thing. Dust Bowl is one of my favorite maps, and it's really a lot of fun, and it's very complicated and complex. There's all kinds of great strategies, and I'm sure you've heard about a lot of them other than mine. You guys have a great show, you've got a great community, and you've got great servers, and I've been enjoying being a part of it. And here's to victory in Dust Bowl.
Victory!